not a black America and a white America and Latino America and Asian America. There's the United States of America.
We live in a perceived post-race and colorblind society where racism is seen as an issue of the past. The discussion and implementation of race in the U.S. functions as an ideology that influences the way people think and act, all of which is then reflected through media outlets.
But the reality is the perception in communities of color is that the system's not working. We've got to do a much better job to make people feel and know that our system does work equally for everyone.
Television, as one of the media's most powerful and influential sources in our society, shows what race means, its problems, and what it looks like, which in turn influences people's truths. There is no singular black experience because intersectionality exists within the African American culture. The representations of blackness on television are not authentic. As a matter of fact, nothing on television is truly authentic. There is a pressure to address but not indulge too heavily in the representations of racial differences on television. And the tension of creating characters either too white or too black have been and continue to be a difficult task.
The fact that white America has consistently, even when things were obvious in retrospect, not seeing the problem tells us that we have a significant gap in perception, that people of color are experiencing the country one way and therefore they perceive its institutions one way. White America perceives it differently because by and large we're experiencing it differently. It isn't that we are uncaring, unconcerned, or mean and evil people. It's that being white means never having to know the reality of those who live a very different experience. And that, to me, is the core of our problem in this country.
Subsequently, television series production crews often find themselves in a bind when they attempt to display what they believe to be true, while also creating characters and a narrative that are highly markable to white audiences. This is where the use of tropes drawn from black repertoire, as well as the use of inferential and overt racism or prejudice occur on television, all of which then feeds into the false connotations of blackness and the minimal amount of value placed on black lives in America.
The most disrespected person in America is the black woman. The most unprotected person in America is the black woman. The most neglected person in America is the black woman.
Being a black woman in a white patriarchal society is difficult. In the past, we were denied full citizenship and were not considered real because our appearances and lifestyles did not match white norms or their standards of beauty. Therefore, we were and still are exoticized, mocked, and belittled. Black women are at the bottom of the totem pole of social status and are often forced to choose which form of discrimination to fight and which to overlook, our race or our gender. The lack of black womanhood depicted on television is indicative of the black woman's place in society. Black feminist and author Patricia Hill Collins says, quote, "Black women are full human beings, capable of participation and leadership in the full range of human activities, intellectual, political, social, sexual, spiritual, and economic," end quote. The media, specifically television, reframes our experiences by characterizing and placing us in racial and sexual tropes, such as, but not limited to, the Jezebel, the mammy, the matriarch, and the welfare queen. These tropes, 1, disregard the full history of black womanhood in the U.S., 2, hinder the growth for the formation of new and more accurate depictions, 3, disregard the existence of intersectionality, and 4, alleviate white guilt and blame for the years of oppression placed on groups of difference. In this video essay, I will specifically focus on ABC Network's Scandal television series. My central argument is that its creator, Shonda Rhimes, is suppressing the visibility of her black audience's identities in order to appease white viewers. She does this through her construction of a contemporary post-race, colorblind world where protagonist Olivia Pope is essentially raceless and does not address the racially biased issues that many gladiators, another name for scandal fans, face on a daily basis. Shonda Rhimes, Olivia Pope, and Scandal are all a part of ABC Network's brand in which they work to attract, maintain, and retain fans and viewers. As a result of their persistent efforts, Scandal has become more than just a television series, and Olivia Pope has become more than just its protagonist. Olivia Pope is a hot commodity. Fans want to do more than just watch her on Thursday evenings. They want to embody her, which has led to the creation of Scandal-inspired products.
Team, Elliot Staples, who's the head designer at The Limited, and Lynn Paolo, our costume designer, and myself have been this dynamic trio working together from beginning to end on every level. There are 78 pieces in this book.
Scandal is the first television series since NBC Network's Julia in 1968, starring Diane Carroll, that has an African-American woman as its lead. The construction of Olivia Pope's character is similar to that of Julia Baker.
And so I decided to do a show about a black woman who's independent and who's intelligent and who's respectful.
On screen, both women go against the previously mentioned racialized and sexualized tropes of black womanhood, while also fitting into Aniko Bodrakozi, author of Equal Time, Television and the Civil Rights Movement, definition of an upper-class white Negro. Their flexible character constructions provide unclear representations of both white assimilation and black relatability. Pope and Baker work within a colorblind ideology to bring black women into a white world without any aesthetic markers to signify their racial differences. Olivia Pope is visibly constructed to mirror the societal white norm of a strong-willed, career-oriented woman. Her entire wardrobe consists of neutral business suits and dresses with a simple, elegant design, and is typically accompanied by high heels, a purse, and occasionally elbow-length gloves. Olivia Pope's hair is long, straightened, and controlled. The few instances when her hair is shown in its natural, kinky, and curly form are when she is escaping her life in Washington, D.C. Her drink of choice is always an expensive imported wine, rarely beer, and never liquor. Olivia's upper-class lifestyle distances itself from the realities of black communities. This disconnect between Rhimes' post-race colorblind construction of Olivia Pope and those who are othered by the ideologies of blackness shown within the media contributes to Olivia Pope being raceless, all of which I believe is caused by the hesitance of Scandal writers to switch from their sexy soap opera narratives to the inclusion of more racially based conversations that may ultimately cause white discomfort and possibly affect the series' ratings. Olivia Pope and President Fitzgerald Grant's interracial relationship as the heart of the series' storyline is unrealistic entertainment. Fitz's willingness to do anything to gain Olivia's love is combated with her attempt to live a happy life where she no longer has to feel guilty for being in love and sleeping with another woman's husband.
I am not going to stand in the Rose Garden and hold your hand while you tell the White House press corps that you had an affair with Olivia Pope. And I am certainly not going to sit in the blue room of the White House and hold your hand while you tell James how you couldn't keep your hands off her on the campaign trail. How the Secret Service drives you to her apartment in defiance of security protocols. How, when you were shot, the name that you called out was Olivia. Or any of the many ways that you have degraded our marriage. Because that is not you making a mistake. That is not you cheating on me. That is you...
That is me being in love with another woman.
Disregarding the impact of racial and cultural differences in favor of a comfortable post-race colorblind love story does a disservice to Scandal's audiences of color. In season 2, episode 8, Happy Birthday, Mr. President, Olivia Pope, in a moment of frustration, tells Fitz,
"Somehow I've become this person who I have no words.
We are together. That's all that matters.
Really? Because I'm feeling a little, I don't know, Sally Hemings, Thomas Jefferson about all this. I have to go."
This episode references the alleged sexual and consensual relationship between the late President Thomas Jefferson and his slave Sally Hemings.
Did you need something?
The Sally Hemings Thomas Jefferson comment was below the belt.
Because it's so untrue.
You're playing the race card on the fact that I'm in love with you? Come on. Don't belittle us. It's insulting and beneath you and designed to drive me away. I'm not going away.
I don't have to drive you away. You're married. You have children. You're the leader of the free world. You are away. By definition, you're away. You're unavailable.
There's no Sally or Thomas here. You're nobody's victim, Liv. I belong to you. We're in this together.
This episode made racial difference visible. However, by referencing slavery, it has simultaneously highlighted how much time has passed since that period and is implying that the U.S. has progressed and is now a post-race society. Scandal cast, crew, and writers allow their fans to have a participatory relationship with the TV series in the efforts to make it more meaningful to viewers.
We watch it so that when all we live through. Tweet, we actually know what the episode is before it airs. Yeah. And so it's like our homework that we do to be able to be fully present for the fans.
Two of the main reasons for which I believe Scandal has gained its success is through social media and its highly marketable storyline.
Shonda Rhimes, our creator and our executive producer, the brilliant Shonda Rhimes. She has a very active life on Twitter, and she kind of got everybody involved. And now everybody in our Scandal family tweets. The props department tweets, the camera department, our transportation department, the whole Scandal office crew, everybody tweets because we love the show.
Social media sites such as Twitter and Tumblr have been used as a way to keep Scandal's cast and crew in touch with its fans. They are given access to hear cast thoughts on episodes, see pictures of what is going on backstage, and much more. End quote, it's handled, ABC, end quote, by author Kristen J. Warner, discusses how black female fans jumped at the opportunity to make Olivia Pope a reflection of themselves. They did this by filling in the gaps that Rhimes' use of colorblind left open. I believe that these black female gladiators were decoding the Scandal series with one of the three hypothetical positions Stuart Hall, author of Encoding and Decoding, terms as oppositional reading. This is when viewers understand both the literal and connotative messages within the show. However, they create their own meanings, rules, and perspectives of what's taking place. This failure to acknowledge racial issues and differences on Scandal reaffirms the functions of post-racism and colorblindness as distractions to the existence of racism and prejudice in America. While all black women's experiences vary, the goal of becoming visible in a society that often overlooks our existence remains the same. In order to create long-lasting effective change in the representation and reception of black women, collective action among people of all races, genders, and classes must take place. So what will you do to help your fellow black sisters?
People been talking about it. We won't just stand here in silence. Can't stop the fire from rising. Whoa.
People, don't you be afraid. So many innocents slain. This is an era for change.